I'm sure that bell's gonna ring. And there it is. I always, you know what I hear first? Is when I'm listening, I hear the voice says, I hear it. Calling us to stand for our call to worship with words from Psalm 19. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Let the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you. Let us worship God. Please remain standing and join with me in our hymn of preparation, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, hymn number 319. Please remain standing and join with me in the prayer of approach that you will find printed in your bulletin. Lord God, open our eyes to your truth. Help us to let the scales fall away that blind us. Allow our spirits to guide us so that we may avoid the pitfalls of pride. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Thank you, April.
Thank you.
how blessed we are with so many gifts and talent. At this time, I would invite all of the children in the sanctuary to come on down to the front. Welcome all of the children. Anyone under like 45, come on down. You know, it's okay to be the first one because then the second one feels better. Look, there's the second one. It was a close race. It really was. Do we have anyone coming from the balcony? If we do, walk on the stairs. Hello, I'm glad you're coming. This is a great way to meet the girls. That's true whether you're 11 or whether you're 90. I'm just pointing it out. You have a pretty good percentage chance, you know. Good morning. Oh, you guys said that so sweet, but it didn't do a thing for the fans. You know, though, no, but that was a good one. That was a little helpful, but I think we need to kick it up just a notch. You know, so do you know that there's a volume control inside of each and every one of you? So I want you to reach in your imagination, reach into that volume control. And there you go. You're getting there. And turn it all the way up past the red line. You know, we went through the green, we went through the yellow, and now we're into the red line, and then we're going to push it almost as far as it'll go. And I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, good morning. And you guys go, good morning.
Good morning.
That was close, but the time... That you got to work on timing because I do that whole 1, 2, 3, and then I go good morning, and then you guys in unison go good morning. Are you ready? We've got our instructions down. Now, is it after 1? No, it's actually just a little after 10. Is it after 2? No, it's just a little after 10. Is it after 3? Yes. 1, 2, 3, good morning. Good morning. Ready? 1, 2, 3, good morning.
Good morning.
That was the volume. The gain was turned all the way up on that one. You guys did fantastic. You know, I'm just curious, what do we do? Have you ever wondered what it is that people go to church for? What do we do in church? Yeah, what do you think?
To learn about God.
To learn about God. That's a fantastic answer. But is there a way that we learn about God? How can we learn about God? You are being so good and raising your hand. Yes. How do we learn about God?
By saying our prayers.
By saying our prayers. That's a wonderful, because saying our prayers is reminding us that God is interested in us and he wants to hear from us. And sometimes we pray for things because we want God to be reminded, you know, it's kind of like when we grew up, when your parents, probably your grandparents in all honesty, grew up, we had something that came out about this time of year from the JCPenney, from Montgomery Ward's, from Sears. And most of the time, we put them on the chair to help us set higher at the table. But this time of year, we looked at the toys. And we would take a pen and we would circle. Like I always wanted a racetrack or maybe a helicopter or something that it was like that. And I would circle it. And just to help my parents, I would fold, they call that dog earring, which we really shouldn't do to a good book. But I would fold the corner of the page down because sometimes I don't think they found what I wanted. So I would circle that and then fold, dog ear the page. Okay. Yes. Have you ever done that?
Yeah.
Yes. It's always fun. Have you done that?
I actually have to say something else.
You have to say something else. All right.
Why are the cameras here?
Why are or why aren't? Why aren't the cameras? Aren't is like short for are not, right?
Yeah, but why?
Yeah, but why are they here? What is this, a camera? Hello? Hello? Are you sure that's a camera?
Probably.
Hello, it could be a laser.
Probably.
You better watch out. It could be a laser beam. Yep. That would be it. But actually, you want to know, this is one of our cameras. But do you know where the other ones are? Oh, thank you. It's always interesting when you point, you know, you look out at the congregation and they're like, yes, it's right there. It's right over there. That's exactly right. So that's so my grandchildren can watch this too. So let's wave at them. Hi, Penelope. Hi, Harry. Good to see you guys. Go wake up your folks. That's always a good idea. So, you know, there's another way that we learn about God. And we don't have to be in church to pray to God. We don't have to be in church to sing and enjoy the music that tells us stories about God. There's a book that tells us about God. Do you know what that book is? Yes.
The Bible.
I was going to say the Encyclopedia Britannica. But you're right. That's even better. The Bible. And there's a song about the Bible. Because it helps us. That's how I learned to spell the Bible. It goes, the B-I-B-L-E. You want to sing that with me? The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. They know this song too. I stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. Let's do it one more time. The B-I-B-L-E. You too. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. You guys just sounded wonderful. Even as a frog, you sounded wonderful. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads, and we're going to say the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, and all of you can help. That's okay. This is how we learn it, by listening. This is a wonderful way to learn. Are you ready to listen with your ears? I think wonderful praying is wonderful, but we're going to pray. We're going to pray the Lord's Prayer. Are you ready? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. You can go back to your seats or out to children's activity. Thank you.
I usually say amen.
Amen is good too. Good luck this morning. Oh my goodness. You know, I raised three girls, but I have it on good authority that boys are different. Oh my goodness. Oh, I was such a rascal when I was growing up. He is bound for good things. Good morning. And welcome, a special welcome this morning to those of you that may be visiting with us. It's wonderful to see old friends, and it's wonderful to meet new. So we would invite everyone to please take the friendship pad that you will find in the pew rack in front of you. Open it up, sign your name, pass it down the pew, then let it come back open that you might take note of the name of the person seated next to you or even down the pew from you, that you might greet that person by name just a little bit later in the service. And I have an announcement to make. We lit the boilers this morning. This morning. So for those of you that are a little chilly, just cuddle up closer to the person next to you. It's a wonderful way to meet somebody, you know, get to know them a little bit better, stay warm. This is, you know, I remember watching a movie about Eskimos living inside an igloo. And that's what they do. They stay close to each other to stay warm. So let's do that. And it will be nice and toasty. Next Sunday, people are going to be complaining. It's too hot in here. So this is just one of the things that we deal with all throughout the year. The change of seasons. A few announcements. First of all, not in your bulletin, It says, I know this because it says extra announcement for October 8th. Okay. The Presbyterian women will be meeting for a book study this coming Thursday, October 12th at 4 p.m. in the Fireside Lounge. The study is celebrating Sabbath, accepting God's gift of rest and delight. For more information, contact Joyce Aldridge or Ruth Sorensen. You can always call the office. We're always happy to give you the information that we have. Also, another note outside of our bulletin, I received a phone call this past week, just within the last 24 hours, regarding Barb Happel. You know, remember Barb, kind of one of the faithful members of our church who would play her instrument up here. It was always wonderful. Barb is on hospice care. And so we have in the office, we have her address if you'd like to mail her a card. And we will publish that next Sunday as well. So we wanted to just communicate that change of life status for her and invite your thoughts and your prayers for her and her son and daughter-in-law who are looking over her. Remember, we lost Tom in December of 2022. An announcement regarding last Sunday's crop walk. They raised over, our team raised over $3,000 for the mission that helps resolve hunger needs throughout the world. So thank you to everyone who walked. Thank you for everyone who donated and supported the crop walk. Next Sunday, we are distributing third grade Bibles. This is a wonderful opportunity to get the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E, into the hands of our children and our grandchildren. And again, I stress this every time I announce it, but it doesn't have to be a church member. If you have a child in your life that you want to receive a Bible, please, the office needs to know tomorrow, either our Christian educators or the office need to know by tomorrow so we can get those Bibles ordered and write their names in and have that presentation next Sunday at our worship service. It's always very special. Throughout the month of October, we are receiving the Peace and Global Witness offering for issues of social justice. 25% remain here in our local congregation for social justice issues. The last time we did that, it was a wonderful opportunity to help an individual who was dealing with their immigration status, and we made a difference in their lives. So please give generously to that. 25% goes to the presbytery, our mid-councils, and then 50% goes out to Global Witness. So please, please know that that offering is being taken throughout the month, and you will find an envelope in the pew rack in front of you, above and beyond your support of our local congregation. Thank you. And we have a concert. I've been announcing this for some time, but, you know, Seth is almost always sold out whenever he books a concert. I mean, it's just an amazing experience. It was years ago that he came here, and we are so excited that he's circling back and coming back to West Michigan and will be performing for us. Let me get this right. Friday, November 10th at 7 p.m., what we do is one long 90-minute set, and just toward the end of the set, we pass the pitcher just once. And every penny that you give is given to Presbyterian Disaster Relief. And what a wonderful agency this is, because disasters keep happening both locally and abroad. And we can make a difference in the lives of people in need. So please be aware of that. And of course, it goes without saying that one of the great needs today are the people of Palestine and the people of Israel in this conflict that they are in the midst of, and the victims that seem to be just collateral damage for politics. Our thoughts and our prayers going out to everyone in that part of the world. Also, the ladies are continuing. I saw out there they have their pies, and they just look amazing. So apple pies and apple crisp, there's nothing but joy there. They're $12 a piece. What a wonderful opportunity to buy several. And I know people that go up to their hunting camp. They don't bring a gun, but they bring their pies. And they are some of the most popular people at camp. So please, whatever use you have, whether it's the Thanksgiving table, whether it's an opportunity for just a glorious Sunday afternoon, the smells are wonderful and the tastes exceed that. So it's a wonderful fundraiser for our ladies. Are there any other announcements that I may have overlooked? Then please stand up and say good morning to the person standing next to you. Please be seated. Let us pray. Gracious and almighty God, we come before you this day, rejoicing in our hearts for the opportunities that you set before each and every one of us to respond to the touch of your Holy Spirit, to experience you in our lives in a time when sometimes the world can be filled with such adversity and chaos. Gracious God, we know the example of your love and sacrifice. And we pray that you would guide each and every one of us to be a peacemaker, defined within ourselves, beyond our pride, and to recognize that we are called to be servants of love. For those throughout the world, in households close by, and far away. We pray for those who huddle in uncertainty and fear. We pray for those who are caught up in rage and frustration. We pray, Lord, for those who are empowered to make decisions that impact the lives of others. And we would ask your wisdom and your discernment to rest upon them and guide them. We ask forgiveness when we jump to conclusions and judgment. And we pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts as well as our eyes to a new and deeper understanding of your truth. We pray for those who grieve and those who are just beginning to experience the loss of a loved one. Lord, that you would surround them with your love and ease their hearts with the memories and the blessings bestowed upon them. Gracious God, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning continues in the Gospel of Matthew, reading Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 46. If you'd like to follow along in your pew Bible, and I encourage you to do so, Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 46. For those of you that might be following along on our live stream, and maybe you didn't grow up in the Christian church, Matthew is the first gospel in the New Testament, usually toward the back of the thicker Bibles. But it's a wonderful example of the story of Jesus' ministry and life. Join with me now, Matthew chapter 21, reading verses 33 through 46. Listen for the word of God. Listen to another parable Jesus speaks. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruit of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables and realized that he was speaking about them, they wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. Let us pray. Lord God, we pray for calming peace to rest upon us and upon all those on earth who need that spirit of truth and the reassurance of your presence. Open our eyes this day, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. This is the culmination of what has taken three Sundays to begin to unpack. This is the dialogue between Jesus and the leaders of the temple who, remember, a couple Sundays ago, they confronted him with a question: by whose authority, by what authority are you doing these things? Are you coming into the temple? Are you preaching? Are you performing miracles? By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? Because in their mind, it was their authority to give out. They were actually the representatives of God, the leaders of the temple, the chief priests, the scribes, the Pharisees. They lived a life that was socially lifted above those around them. I have said for many years that I am always been reluctant to put myself on a pedestal, because if you don't, you don't have to worry about someone pushing you off. But they were reveling in their pedestal and the opportunity to look down upon others. They dressed the part, they lived the part, they spoke the part. And so they were confronting Jesus. And he began to address their question. But this is the answer. Clearly, in this passage, Jesus explains to them who he is and where he is from and by what authority he does the things that he has been doing. And they didn't like when they figured it out. This was my example of, well, I'm getting ahead of myself, because Jesus continues to teach now in a parable. It's interesting when you're in a debate with another person and they are unwilling to hear any personal criticism or redirection of their own behavior. And so it's interesting when you can draw up an example that pulls them in and they get the message in the lesson, and then at that last moment, they suddenly realize it's as if they took their glasses off and wiped away the obstacles that kept them from seeing, and they realize it was them that Jesus was talking about. He describes, now this is if you were a business-minded person, he describes the project. A wealthy landowner planted a vineyard, built into the vineyard a wine press, built a wall around it, and a watchtower. He was protecting the property. He created a fortress that produced. And then he leased it out to tenants and went to a faraway land. And now, typically, the listener would recognize that the obligation of the tenants to pay back all of the labor and cost of building this edifice would come from the fruit, the produce of the land. And so when the harvest time came, the wealthy landowner from afar sent his slaves. That's always a word that makes many uncomfortable. It can be translated slaves. It can be translated servants. It can be translated employees. It was a cultural norm in its time. But he sent a representative to the people to collect what was due. And the story goes that they beat the representative and then killed another representative and then stoned another representative. And this continued. The landowner would send representatives to the tenants to again request, and you've got to wonder about, number one, the patience and the mindset of this person continuing to send representatives, even larger in crowd, in numbers. And again, they were treated the same way. And so finally, the landowner in the parable that Jesus is speaking, and he's got their rapt attention, says to himself, I will send my son. Surely they will respect my son. Because previously they must have misunderstood something in order to behave in such an outrageous way. But the tenants, Jesus teaches, saw the son, recognized him, and said to themselves, this is the heir. Let us kill him, and all of this will be ours. And that is what they did. And Jesus asks the question to the leaders of the church, the chief priests, the scribes, and the Pharisees. What will the landowner do to those tenants? And the response is powerful. He will take those wretched men. These are the religious authorities answering Jesus. He will take those wretched men and punish them and then lease his property out to those tenants who will who will repay him in due time, that which belongs to him. And suddenly Jesus turns the tide and opens their eyes, and they recognize they are the tenants who have been entrusted with God's truth, who have been given the role to shepherd God's people, and who have abused the prophets and killed the messengers of God, and ultimately will kill the Son of God. If you look at this from a scholarly perspective, you realize Jesus is answering their question, who gave you this authority? And Jesus acknowledges that he was the cornerstone rejected by the builders. He was the one prophesied to come. He was the Son of God. And what is the response of the leaders of the church? They want to kill him. They want to crucify him. The reason they don't, the gospel writer explains, is because they are afraid of the consequences to themselves. Not from God, not at a time of judgment, which seems so far out in the future that we can kind of displace ourselves from it, but from the political repercussions, because the crowd is loving him and loving his message. I think this is the first recorded, documented example of Jesus holding out his hand and dropping the microphone. It's the message. Whether you want to receive it, whether you like what it says, it's God's truth for us. We have been given an obligation, a responsibility. We have been loaned the opportunity to experience the blessings of our life. But that those blessings come with an obligation of care for others. This is not a stewardship sermon. This is not one of those sermons that say, listen, pull out your wallets and write down the big numbers. This is an opportunity to recognize the blessings bestowed upon us and what that means to us. And yes, some of that means the treasure that we've been blessed with and our responsibility to, because we're blessed, to be a blessing to others. You know, there are people that live their life so differently than we do, and many of us are oblivious. And I will tell you, my timing is not always perfect. I remember driving through a fast food drive-thru. I'm at the window, and there's an individual, and I realize that what he's doing is grabbing change that has fallen as the money is being handed to the window, and some of it falls out. And he was running between the cars and grabbing change. And I thought, the thought came to me after I turned the corner and drove out, I should have just handed him my meal. I should have just handed him that which I had bought. It came too late. Now, some of you might say, well, you could have driven around the block, Dan. Yeah. Maybe that's a reality. And that happens to us. We run into those circumstances where we think of, you know, often though, that story has changed just slightly, and we're in an argument and someone has kind of embarrassed us or said something that hurt us or made us a little angry, and we don't have a good response until, an hour later, and we want to text the person our response. Sometimes our timing's wrong. But sometimes there are times that it's like a beam of light shining down upon your head and your shoulders. It provides warmth and comfort and peace, and you know what you are called to do. You are called, as that single mom is struggling and her credit card or debit card has been refused at the grocery store, and yes, you're impatient, and yes, you're frustrated, and yes, you have places to be, but sometimes the realization just as clear as a bell strikes through, and you don't look and see whether you approve of what she bought. You simply say, I've got it. You tell the teller, I'll pay. And it's the right thing to do because you have been blessed to be a blessing. Thank you for your support of this church. I mean, I think as I look in our bulletin and I see our weekly, monthly, and annual giving to date, and you guys have been so extraordinary, exceedingly generous. You know, there was something, I don't know if any of you remember, it was so long ago, it was called a pandemic. And it seems to be raising its ugly head again, because I know many people are struggling with COVID again. It keeps mutating and finding different ways into the house. We closed down worship in our sanctuary, and I remember my wife asked me, how long do you think it'll be? 2 weeks. 62 Sundays later. I mean, I'm sitting in a room basically barely larger than a closet. And I've got a camera that I've had for years, and I've set it up, and I bought a little $35 adapter to take the signal from that camera and put it into a USB card in the computer. And I've got a microphone that I set in front of me, and I just sat there with a Bible and a guitar, and I just talked from my heart. And I remember receiving a card that touched me so deeply. It was from a family south of us along the lakeshore. And they said, you know, we heard you on the radio and we loved your humor and we thought it would be great to worship with you, but you're just too far away. And then this thing happened and we found you by Googling. Who would have thought? And we've been watching you and enjoying you. And we just wanted to tell you a little bit about ourselves and wish you well and encourage you to keep up the good work. And in the card, not even alluded to in the message, was a check for several hundred dollars. I mean, it touched me in such a powerful way. Now, sometimes people, you know, there are times in our lives we came back from vacation with our kids, and in order to get out of long-term parking, I had to have everyone get out and search the seat cushions. We took the change out of the ashtray in order to pay to get the car out of, that's a sign of a good vacation. But there, I'm saying that because there have been times when things have been a struggle for us. I get it. I absolutely understand. But thank you for giving your talent, Tina. Thank you for sharing, April. I'm sorry. See, Tina is literally right behind you. Literally right behind. And my eyes went, and April's like, what the heck? My point is, treasure comes in a variety of forms. Even your smiles can be treasure and make a difference in the lives of those around you, because maybe that person seated next to you or close by you hasn't had any affection shown to them in a long, long time. And a handshake, a smile, a welcome invitation to a cookie and coffee is the greatest gift that they could receive this day. And it is a reflection of God's love. So I'm urging you to recognize this message, this story, because they got it. They realized it was them that Jesus was talking about. And they themselves laid out their own judgment. Those wretched people, those wretched tenants, God will expand the church and has done so And the church now, the body of Christ, appears in so many ways beyond walls of any sanctuary and touches the lives almost beyond our ability to imagine. The grace of God available for all. Treasure indeed. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for your word and your message, even, Lord, when we don't want to hear it, or when we are forced to recognize and acknowledge that it is ourselves who fall short. Lord God, thank you for your loving grace in those times. And help us to see and recognize in the moment the opportunity to touch the life of another. In Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn of praise, It Is No Secret, hymn number 581. Please be seated. Let us pray. Lord, receive these gifts from the bounty afforded to us. Lord, use them for the furtherance of your kingdom, to lift up your love and your grace to all. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us now return unto God a portion of what is already His, our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. All right, I know you're going to be doing your thing in just a minute, but I, you know, April, what's the highest note on that score? If you have to go back up and check it, it's a, that's my favorite note. I just love that note. Thank you once again. Please remain standing and turn in your hymnal to number 98 as we sing our hymn of faith, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
And now go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hi, Abriel. It's good to see you.